Transformation Services. Join us every Tuesday evening as we continue to do what we do best, linking people and government.
You're watching the ZNS Network, the People Station.
Services working to tackle the backlog in the food assistance program. And child abuse cases on the rise. Experts on Grand Bahama share insights on recognizing the signs. The Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition, starts now.
This is the Bahamas Tonight, Northern Edition.
This is the Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition. Good evening, all. I'm Azure Quant. Thank you so much for tuning in. Topping news, food assistance remains a challenge on Grand Bahama, with roughly 3,000 Grand Bahama residents awaiting approval for the Ministry of Social Services and Urban Development's food assistance program. Numbers are steadily climbing. As Raven Davis tells us in this report, officials are grappling with the challenge of distinguishing genuine need from opportunistic claims. Here's that report.
It's an uphill battle for social services workers in Grand Bahama who are reportedly swamped with requests for food assistance by residents. Northern Bahamas District Chief Welfare Officer Dorothea Gomez revealing that earlier efforts to tackle the backlog through an overtime exercise only scratched the surface.
But of course, you know, people are applying every day, so it's like you make one step forward and then step backwards.
Yeah.
So we're working through our backlog. We've made a little progress, but of course, you know, there's still room for more.
In addition to the sheer volume of requests, the island's economy is a compounding factor. Currently, nearly 3,000 persons are waiting to be approved, and the number is steadily growing.
We don't have the manpower to deal with the amount of cases that comes in on a regular basis. I can go on the system now and I could see we may have knocked out, for instance, let's say during overtime we knocked out 2,000 out of 4, or that's just, you know, a figure out there. I can go on the system now and maybe back up to 3,000 plus.
The food assistance program plays a crucial role in providing aid to those facing severe hardship, unable to find food for themselves and their families. It targets individuals grappling with insufficient or no income to meet their basic needs. However, Gomez underscores a critical obstacle, separating genuine need from those just trying to take advantage of the system.
Of course, we have seen persons who don't need. You may get in a little situation right now where you can benefit from them. Emergency food assistance, but then you feel that should be ongoing. And with people now being able to go online and apply, people know how to manipulate the system. And you know, there are persons that are employed but are still in need. You can understand that.
She emphasizes the department's unwavering dedication to assisting those in need and assures the public that social services workers are diligently working to tackle the backlog. For the Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition, I'm Raven Davis.
In other news, the month of April is recognized as Child Abuse Prevention Month. Statistics from the Department of Social Services revealing an alarming increase of child abuse cases in the country within the last 3 years, particularly following the COVID-19 pandemic. Tonight, the director of the Grand Bahama Children's Home is giving insights into the signs of child abuse. Shalia Roll has the details in this story.
The Grand Bahama Children's Home remains a safe haven by providing refuge for children experiencing various forms of mistreatment. As April is Child Abuse Prevention Month, Director Joan Hutchinson reminds the public to stay vigilant for signs of child abuse in children.
It's not that we're going to have an increase, but there's always going to be a consistent number of children that will come.
As these children are coming from many backgrounds, the staff at the children's home is intentional on how they provide structure and discipline to the kids.
It's a difficult process. We don't have corporal punishment for the kids, so a lot of it is talking them through some of the misbehavior that they have. And I know old school would say, well, you know, you got to spank the children, that's the only way they are going to learn. However, they've already been abused. To add more to that is really not solving the problem. Correction, yes. And so even if I were to fuss at them or they got a consequence, I have to come back like a parent would do and give them the love right behind it. Listen, it's not that we don't love you. It's because we love you that we need to make sure that you're doing the right thing, because later on you're going to go out into the world and we want you to be able to be proud of yourself just as we're proud of you.
Finding mental health resources has been challenging for the home, as there are not many facilities on the island of Grand Bahama to assist with mental health challenges.
When the children come here, they have any number of issues, whether it's academic, emotional, psychological. And so we have been trying to find mental health therapists and training for the children, yes, to be able to help them to get through some of these things. It's an ongoing process. We're limited here in Grand Bahama with persons being able to render those services.
The children's home director says that there are many signs to abuse in children, such as the child being withdrawn, a delay in development, and a lack of self-confidence.
If you are a teacher who are key to seeing a lot of the signs, still bedwetting or still coming to school, not clean, with an odor perhaps, not having lunch, and not necessarily because they can't afford it, but again, a conversation to find out, well, what's happening at home? Why don't you have lunch? Why don't you have snack?
For the Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition, I'm Shalia Rule.
Thank you, Shalia. Well, in news from the crime beat, police on Grand Bahama confiscated a firearm on Friday, April 12, 2024, around 3:50 p.m. Preliminary reports indicated that a team of officers arrived on Kings Lake Lane and Hudson Avenue, where they searched a bushy area and found a firearm containing ammunition. No arrests were made in connection with this incident. In news from Abaco, tourism on that northern island is experiencing an unprecedented surge, with visitor numbers on the rise and establishments fully booked for the upcoming summer season. The Member of Parliament for Central and South Abaco and Parliamentary Secretary in the Ministry of Tourism is expressing his excitement tonight.
Like I say, Abaco is hot, hot, hot.
Member of Parliament for Central and South Abaco and Parliamentary Secretary in the Ministry of Tourism, John Pinder, says the economy of Abaco is booming as a result of an increase in tourism numbers on the island. Statistics reveal a 13% rise from last year.
We don't do much cruise in Abaco, but in terms of stopover visitors, we're number two in the country. We have the second busiest airport in the country, and we're doing quite well. The first 2 months of this year, we're up 13% from last year, so I'm expecting that 2024 will eclipse the numbers of 2019.
Pinder crediting this success to 2 years of dedicated effort in putting Abaco back on the map and emphasizing the island's revitalized facilities. He adds that the proximity of Abaco to the United States makes it an easily accessible destination.
Our friends from abroad is what I like to call them. And they're coming in droves, and they're telling their friends, and their friends are telling their friends. They're coming by boat, by plane. They're staying at all of our various establishments. What you would find is Abaco's ability to cater to all budgets is enabling us to open arms and bring our friends from abroad here to show them what Abaco really has to offer.
Tourists visiting on yachts also showing strong signs of increase, as he has observed a significant amount of boats in the water.
The number of super yachts anchored throughout the seas of Abaco's show that this is not just hot for fly-in tourism, but yachting. And yachts are one of those special things. You don't expect them to bring a great revenue into the islands, but they truly do. They're the ones going out to dinner. They're the ones fueling their boats and provisioning and utilizing those mom and pop gift stores and whatnot throughout the Keys and on the mainland as well. So yachting is actually doing better than it had done previous to Dorian.
MP Pinder expressing his enthusiasm for the upcoming summer months, noting that establishments on Abaco already booked. Here on Grand Bahama, orientation for the 16th cohort of the National Training Agency's Mandatory Workforce Preparatory Program getting underway. Collaborating with the Ministry for Grand Bahama, the program marks a significant milestone, signaling a fresh chapter in professional development for its participants. Raven Davis reports.
Participants from diverse backgrounds convening at the Ministry for Grand Bahama's CoLab Center, brimming with anticipation for the transformative journey ahead. Guided by seasoned facilitators, the cohort will embark on a 14-week program designed to enhance their skill sets and unlock their full potential in the workforce.
The National Training Agency was born, birthed, created to facilitate the training, skills, competency-based training needed to undergird the workforce.
Over the course of 4 weeks, the 30 participants will immerse themselves in soft skills training, followed by 10 weeks of skills training, spanning office procedures and non-instructional teacher's aid courses.
These young people are going to go through City and Guilds, an international certification and office procedures, so that as they go into the workplace, not only are they competent, but they are qualified. And the teacher's aid through the Ebenezer College, that is NACOB approved, they are able to go into the school system.
Facilitators underscoring the pivotal role of soft skills training, noting that success in the workforce hinges on mastering these essential abilities.
So soft skills training, there are actually 12 modules that they will cover. 12 modules, those modules include attitude, shape up, they include team building. There's also customer service, communication skills, leadership skills, and lots more.
Those who are here are considered trainees, and they will be trained on what it is that they need to do to make themselves marketable, to make themselves employable, and not just in the short term, but for the long haul.
Now, we also got a chance to hear from some of the participants. They tell us they're enthusiastic about acquiring new skills and knowledge.
I'm a home baker, but I wanted to get a profession. I love kids and I love learning, so I was happy when I saw this program. Because I feel like with different workforce, when you don't have training in it, there's a good, like, step foot inside of it.
Just to learn all the skills I need to help another teacher, and then eventually, once the program is finished, I would want to go to school to be a teacher.
The 17th cohort is reportedly projected for September, and the NTA team is working feverishly to get it off the ground. Meantime, interested persons are invited to visit ntabahamas.org to register to be a part of this program. For the Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition, I'm Raven Davis.
The E. Clement National Arts Festival continuing to put the human talent.
You have enough things to worry about. Living in a world that can seem opposite of the things you are trying to accomplish.
I can need a little help with this one, please.
We're here to let you know that you don't have to go at it alone. Choose peace of mind. Choose comfort. Choose CB. Commonwealth Bank, leader in personal banking services.
Unwind every Thursday, Friday, and Saturday from 5 to 7 p.m. at the Prop Club at the Grand Lucayan Hotel. Enjoy tasty food specials on draft beers and house specialty pizzas. The Prop Club, the best place to meet friends and enjoy happy hour.
It's the Come Go With Me Best of the Best Bahamas and Turks and Caicos Concert Weekend, Providenciales Turks and Caicos. Day 2, the pre-party on Friday, June 28th. For more information, email comegowithmeweekend@gmail.com.
We're down to the grand finale. We've been working long, hard.
Everything has been unexpected, so I don't know. I don't know what to expect today.
We don't know if it's weightlifting or cardio, but whatever it is, we just can take it on head first.
We know coming to this competition, we come in to win it all.
Your number one news team covering the North. The Bahamas Tonight, Northern Edition.
Welcome back. For over 65 years, the E. Clement Bethel National Arts Festival has been a steadfast celebration of Bahamian talent. This year's event saw young and gifted Bahamians taking the stage to showcase their musical gifts. Shalia Roll brings us the highlights in this report.
Sopranos, altos, tenors, all showing out at the 2024 E. Clement Bethel National Arts Festival. But according to adjudicator Adrian Archer, this is nothing new for Grand Bahama.
Grand Bahama always seems to bring the fire, if that's such a thing. The singers are amazing. I've done this now for 3 or 4 years, and every year they seem to step up the game.
The National Arts Festival, a community staple since 1959, has consistently celebrated local talent, becoming a showcase of creativity. The competition expanding to include various forms of art, such as music, visual arts, and film.
What we expect from the youth, the community, whether it's high school, preschool, primary school, is for them to bring whatever it is that they are blessed with as far as talent is concerned.
The Director of Cultural Affairs, His Excellency Kevin G. Tomlinson, who is no stranger to the music industry, speaking to the great talent that has come forth to participate this time around.
This year in particular, more and more talents have shown up here at the Arts Festival and have demonstrated such great, a different standard of performances that is coming out.
And the students also chiming in on why they chose the music industry.
It's very freeing and it allows us to come together, especially as a music department, and just perform and do what we love.
It's a gift God gave me.
Singing, dancing, music, it is my passion and I would like to show it to the world.
For the Bahamas Tonight, the Northern Edition, I'm Shalia Rule.
Well, Sylvia Poitier, a mother of two children with sickle cell disease, has led her to write a powerful book titled Facing Two Sickles. The book takes readers through her family's experience living with the challenges of sickle cell, from diagnosis to loss and everything in between. Here's more in this next report.
We call ourselves caregivers, and we call our children warriors.
Sylvia Poitier, detailing in her new book, Facing Two Sickles, the experiences of raising children with the sickle cell disease. The book, comprising of 17 chapters, each offering a candid glimpse into the life she and her husband, Floyd, shared with their son and daughter, Vashti and Vance.
The book is to let them know they're not in this alone, and how to deal with it, how I've dealt with it, and also to build a faith.
It all began with the couple discovering that they carried the sickle cell trait, which meant a 25% chance of passing the disease on to one of four children.
We have the trait, but you're so caught up in the moment of love that you didn't read on to say, well, okay, what happens if two persons with sickle cell trait connect?
Despite the odds, they welcomed their first child, Vashti, into the world, and a few months later, she was diagnosed with the disease. Doctors cautioning against further pregnancies, warning of the challenges that lie ahead.
Well, fate had it. There came along a second one. And I said, okay, God, what's going to happen here? 6 months later, he got his testing. He was discovered to have the disease.
And after 21 years of battling the disease with both children while still ensuring a normal life, on May 20th, 2012, at the age of 21, Vashti succumbed to the disease, leaving her parents and brother shattered, but determined to honor her memory with this book.
She always talked about it as she wants people to know that sickle cell is there and mommy, don't let it happen to other people. She would always say, well, what about a foundation? Let's do a foundation. People need to know this is not easy. I said, okay. And you know, I would always say, okay. So finally when it happened, I said, okay, now I'll sit down and put pen to paper.
Using her pain to advocate for others facing similar struggles, Sylvia urges those dealing with sickle cell disease to seek support from the Bahamas Sickle Cell Association while also inviting to join in celebrating World Sickle Cell Awareness Day on June 19th, 2024.
It's made up of over 113 members of caregivers and persons with the disease. So you, us here in the Bahamas, may not be aware that there are so many children battling the disease. In the group, we share ideas, we pray for each other, encourage one another when persons are in the hospital. And so you're not alone.
For anyone wanting to purchase the book, you can visit www.amazon.com and search Facing Two Sickles. That's a look at stories making news. Up next is our special segment, Ask GBPC.
GB Power, can you tell me ways that I could cut down on our power bill?
Up to half of the energy consumed in homes is attributed to heating and cooling systems. Making informed decisions about your home's HVAC system can significantly impact both your utility bills and comfort. As summer approaches and temperatures soar, many will rely on their AC units. However, all air conditioning units are not created equal. It's essential to be cautious when selecting one, as some may seem cost-effective initially, but end up being more expensive in the long term. One crucial factor to consider is the SEER rating, which stands for Seasonal Energy Efficiency Ratio. A higher SEER rating means more comfort for every energy dollar spent. SEER ratings typically range from 13 to 22 and cost less to operate the higher the SEER. For instance, a 2-ton unit with a SEER rating of 13 may cost around 57 cents per hour to operate, whereas a unit with a SEER rating of 18 or 20 could cost only 36 cents per hour. Take some time to familiarize and understand what a SEER rating is and how much your unit is costing you for each hour it runs. For a full guide on cooling and its costs, visit our website at gb-power.com. Be sure to tune in next week as we dive into insulation and how optimizing your home's insulation can help your AC to run more efficiently.
Now, if you have any questions that you would like to ask GBPC, contact us on our Facebook page at ZNS Northern Service. With our Jay Philippe for the latest in sports. Jay?
Even some new equipment, also scores and highlights from Little League Baseball. Stay tuned, more right after this.
Chad Cawley and the VIP. Don't miss the best of the best. Turks and Caicos Islands. June 27th through 30th. TCI. Be there.
Hi. I want to put some shoes on your feet.
Hi. I want to put some shoes on your feet.
I still want to put shoes on your feet.
I want to put some shoes on your feet.
And I still want to put shoes on your feet.
We still want to put shoes on your feet.
Two locations to put shoes on your feet. Downtown Freeport and now our newest location in the Carmichael City Shopping Plaza, right behind the Walk-Up Wendy's, Carmichael Road West.
Janice, Mother's Day is coming up and I'm thinking about upgrading my kids' mother's kitchen.
Man, I thought your children's mother was married to another man. You have to know when to let go.
This is powerful. You know what? I'm going to upgrade my wife's kitchen for Mother's Day. I am sure she would love that.
I think so too. Check out Cornet Bahamas. They're having a pre-Mother's Day sale, 35% off store-wide starting April 16th through May 16th. The Sandy Port Plaza, Freeport, Abaco, and Ilu.
Day, good evening, and good vibes to my Power Nation. I hope you guys are doing so good. You know you got it locked in with the one and only Angel M, baby.
What you doing in the sky, gal?
Listening to Power 104.5 FM.
You still listening to the show, gal?
Yes, Angel M Salon.
Gal, bitch, I'm perfect. Yeah. Trouble when she turn it. Need your service. We'll slime hot like a furnace. Hey, gal, what you doing to me? Doing to me? Girl, what you doing to me? Doing to me?
Tune into Good Vibes with Angel M from 2 to 6 on Power 104.5 FM.
Ladies and gents, I'm Jay Philippe, and welcome to Sports. I have a whole lot of sports for you. Let's begin with Shane Stubbs.
The Lewis-Yard Eagles received a big-time donation of brand-new basketball rims from local basketball veteran Trevor Bain.
I feel like the timing should have happened a long time ago. To be honest with you, the court is horrible. Backboards ain't no good. They don't have no rims. Hopefully, someone could donate more backboards and refurbish the court and paint it over and stuff like that. And
overcoming those conditions as a small school to sit at the top of the mountain was no easy feat. And the Eagles believe the donation should go a long way.
Plenty of times the basketball went through that hole, but it was motivation to push through.
It was a good practice for us so we could win the championships.
I think it's even better because we plan for our future generation and the girls' team can have a better chance to practice and they don't have to go to what we had to go to.
The Eagles won the girls' title of the Jimmy Calmer Keith Mullings Basketball League earlier this year, and this could bode well for their title defense.
Thank you, Mr. Bean.
For ZNS Total Sports, I'm Shane Stubbs.
Switching gears now in sports, scores from primary school softball Wilbur Outen Academy went into the final inning with a 8-run lead and managed to close out that game after Bartlett Hill scored 6 runs late in the game. The final score was 18-16.
First starting off, it was a little rocky, but in the middle of the game, they catch up. Definitely we have to work on catching. We have to work on some more catching, but with the batting, they're good with that.
Even though we lost the game, mainly it was mental. It was a mental thing for them, you know. I told them just keep their head in the game. It's a lot of times to get down on themselves, especially my pitcher. You throw one or two bad pitches, you know, it gets yourself out of the game. But that's one thing we have to work on, that mental toughness, and just learn how to play together.
Hugh Campbell also got the win against Holmes Rock Primary, 23-1. And finally, in sports, scores from Little League Baseball, Pelican Bay got the win against FES 15-7 in 8U play and 10U action. MSC Shippers shut out Riviera and Associates 9-0. Now in 12U, Silver Lion Builders won against the Royals 10-5, and the Lions scored 6 runs in a 6-4 win versus the Royals. In 16U play, the Lions dominated the Red Sox 18-9, and the Lions again was victorious against the Yankees 6-2. And that is your quick check on sports, ladies and gents. I'm Jay Philippe. As always, be blessed.
And here's a check on your local weather forecast, sponsored by Royal Star Assurance.
Tonight's weather forecast is brought to you by Royal Star Assurance.
'Cause it's so beautiful.
Don't go anywhere. Our Facebook friend of the day is up next.
Jones Best, the best of the best. Turks and Caicos Islands, June 27th through 30th. TCI. Be there. It's your
We all need to save. Save time, gas, and money. Shopping at Save More can help you do just that. Make us your first stop for all your prescription needs and medical supplies. Get all your health and beauty items at the same time. And don't miss our huge choice of snacks to satisfy your cravings. And the largest vitamin selection and over-the-counter relief products. Need diapers and other baby care items? First stop. The new section for makeovers, cosmetics, and beautiful jewelry will make you sparkle for that next special event. Save More Drugs, your more store.
Sean A. Miller-Weibo tying up, but it doesn't matter. It's gold for the Olympic champions.
On May 4th and 5th, the sun will shine down on the Thomas A. Robinson Stadium. Hundreds of the world's best track athletes from more than 40 countries will compete to qualify for their spot at the Paris Olympics.
We're down to the grand finale. We've been working long, hard.
Everything has been unexpected, so I don't know. I don't know what to expect today.
We don't know if it's weightlifting or cardio, but whatever it is, we just can take it on head first.
We know coming to this competition, we come in to win it all.
Your number one news team covering the North. The Bahamas Tonight, Northern Edition.
Bradlina Williams, you are our Facebook friend of the day, and also His Excellency Kevin Tomlinson. A special happy birthday going out to you both. We hope you are enjoying, and that's going to do it tonight for us here in the North. I'm Azure Quant, but don't go anywhere. The Bahamas Tonight continues.
Coming up in the Bahamas Tonight, the national report, social media's impact on sex crimes. The DPM pitches sustainable tourism at UN, hurricane hunting in the Bahamas, and in sports, World Relays team named. The Bahamas Tonight, the national report, starts now.
ZNS News is brought to you by the new BTC. Fiber is here. Faster, stronger, more reliable. Together, we are unstoppable. Switch today.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Akush Lapinder, and this is The Bahamas Tonight, the national report. Thanks for tuning in. Brief, deliberate, direct. That pretty much sums up Deputy Prime Minister and Tourism Minister, the Honorable Chester Cooper's address today at a special United Nations General Assembly Summit. On the world stage, the DPM, holding nothing back, expressed frustration over what his government deems unfair, unjust, and unacceptable practices from international financial regulators. This UN conference addresses debt restructuring, socioeconomic equality, and sustainability in tourism. On the issue of tourism, Mr. Cooper also hit out over those recent travel advisories issued by the US and Canada.
As a destination, we live and breathe by our reputation. Therefore, it is critical to highlight that travel advisories issued by large nations about the Bahamas and other Caribbean destinations have the potential to do incredible harm to our economies and disrupt our sustainability efforts. We believe the release of these advisories without context is unfair and portrays a sensational narrative that we must expend scarce resources to correct. Additionally, we have attracted more than $10 billion in balanced tourist investments to the Bahamas in the past 3 years alone, building connectivity with airport and seaport infrastructure, resorts, and the massive integration of renewable energy. We are scaling our approach through a destination stewardship program designed in collaboration with the Global Sustainable Tourism Council. Notwithstanding, it is important to point out that the existing punishing one-size-fits-all rules and adverse listings from global economic organizations we are not a part of and we had no hand in creating, make it all the more difficult to attract the foreign direct investments small island developing states critically need.
The Deputy Prime Minister calling for fairness, stressing that the UN is the appropriate body to set such proper standards. In other news this evening, some may argue that unlawful sexual intercourse mainly impacts adults. Police, however, have confirmed that's not the trend they've seen. Aldevis Munnings joins us live in studio tonight on what real-life experiences suggest. Good evening, Aldevis.
Good evening to you, Mokushla, and good evening, Bahamas. Let's start with the stats. Police Commissioner Clayton Fernander on Monday revealing that 134 unlawful sexual intercourse cases were reported in 2023 compared to 139 in 2022. Now, that's a 4% decrease. We also heard that 75% of the victims knew their assailant.
We continue to arrest individuals who take advantage of our young darlings, and we will not stand by to let that continue to happen. We are charging a number of persons where we get the information and identify the persons responsible, and we are putting them before the court.
But Inspector Jewel Gray of the Police Force's Sexual Offenses Unit takes it a bit further, disclosing that unlawful sexual intercourse cases are rising between male and female juveniles, specifically school-aged children between the ages of 12 and 15 years old. As Gray tells it, the youngsters download social media platforms like Facebook, TikTok, and WhatsApp on their mobile phones to engage in conversations that lead to relationships that eventually involve sexual intercourse.
It just needs a little bit more supervision. I guess if parents will go through their kids' phones, see what's on there. I mean, that's a lot of what we see going on now. You have a lot of hardworking parents out there who are providing and doing their best to give the best education, you know, the best resources they can to their child. But sometimes it's just, you know, bad influence. Some kids, you know, they're around friends. That peer pressure play a major role as to that need to want to fit in, to be a part of. So it's not just, say, the parents not paying attention, because you as a parent could do and supervise as much as you want, but if that child determined that they're going to do something, they're going to do it.
And sexual offenses unit officers use the victim-centric approach to ensure juveniles learn their lesson once in police custody.
It's not just trying to penalize or criminalize somebody, but we're trying to get them the necessary help that they need. Find out what exactly is going on in the homes. What are they being exposed to? So it's trying to seek help, whether it's some broken home or whatever the case may be. So it's not just looking to say, well, I'm going to arrest this person. We're trying to build better citizens. So, of course, we want to express to them, education is key. Focus on your work. You know, give them that positive motivation to do better.
To enforce the safety message, sexual offenses unit officers usually visit schools to further educate our youth on how to prevent becoming a victim of unlawful sexual intercourse. Reporting live in studio for the Bahamas Tonight, I'm Altavis Munnings. Back to you, Mokushla.
Well, thanks, Altavis. Meantime, one day after that tragic shooting in the Yellow Elder community Monday, claiming the life of 28-year-old DeMarcus McIntosh, our Lloyd Allen reporting from the scene, sharing more on how the family is coping and what some are doing to curb crime in that area. Good evening, Lloyd.
Well, Makosha, today we're returning back to the scene of that fatal shooting that took place in the area of Nelson Street, Yellow Elder Communities on Monday. Today, as we've returned, we're now speaking with the mother of the victim. She is Lorraine Pratt McIntosh, and she's saying, she's telling us about the last time she spoke with her son.
Well, the last time I spoke with him was on Sunday evening. And I say, Mama, so I say, where you at? He say, Mommy, I right through the corner. I say, now hurry up, go home, because you know all of these killings going on in Nassau. Just hurry up, go home. You know, he say, Mommy, he say, I straight. I say, okay. And then yesterday I came home from work. I received a call that he was dead. And I was like, wow. And I just go on, hey, why us? You know?
Now, of course, at this time, it's difficult for any family. But, of course, there is a road forward for your family. Your son has a number of children as well.
Well, he has two little boys. So I think one is 6, and I think the other is 5. Yes, he left behind 2 beautiful little boys.
Now, additionally, Makusha, we spoke yesterday with the Member of Parliament for the area, as well as a community activist, both of whom suggested a number of positive activities for young people to divert them from crime.
There's a correlation between these things happening with persons being unemployed. And one of the first things we did as my team, we decided to try and give as many as these young men an opportunity.
This kind of violence is becoming prevalent, and hope to evangelize as many of the residents in these communities as possible. I believe that's one of the shortcuts to helping to stem and bend the curve.
Others shared more about the victim as well as safety concerns.
A shooting happened recently out there in Yala Ella Park, which I didn't like because we have a lot of children out there almost every day playing basketball and doing other activities, and I found that very, very unsafe.
But basically, I call him my twin because we're only a year apart. So that was like literally my everything. So basically now going back to work can be a hassle because that was my alarm in the morning. That was my clock. He's a nightmare every morning.
I don't understand why somebody will do something like this to mamas. All he want to do is fix motorbike, fix something. All he want to do is fix.
He was a loving boy. He'd do anything for him. He'd do anything for you. He'd go away for people. He was a loving person.
He was a nice person. He feel, you know, he was all right. He'd do anything for anybody.
Now, Makusha, as investigations continue, at last report, police indicated that they were on the hunt for a Japanese model vehicle believed to be related to this latest shooting, that again taking the life of 29-year-old DeMarcus McIntosh. Reporting from the Yellow Island community, for the Bahamas Tonight, I'm Lloyd Allen. Makusha.
Well, thanks, Lloyd. In any given year, a number of people, young, old, male, female, you name it, are reported missing. 2023, no exception. Police Commissioner Clayton Fernando disclosing during Monday's police briefing that last year, some 311 people could not be found. To date, though, 263 of those cases have been closed.
The individuals were found safe. 48 cases remain open, and the factors that we are noticing with the missing person due to mental illness, sometimes miscommunication, maybe loss at sea, some of them lost at sea, and we want to say to family members, and most of them are senior citizens. Most of them, the missing persons, let's pay attention to our senior citizens, man. They are the show list that we are standing on today.
All officials stand on the premise that police officers are not above the law. Last year ended with 192 complaints against them, a 40% increase over 2022. According to the police commissioner, 101 of those cases are under active investigation, while 50 were unfounded. Noting that a number of officers who have gone afoul of the law this year have been placed before the courts, Commissioner Fernando insists there is no place on the police force for those involved in crime.
And where we find that they go contrary, they are charged and put before the court. We want to build that trust with the Bahamian people, that they want to know that their police officers are with them and not against them. So we want to ensure that discipline is the order of the day. For this top team, discipline is the order of the day. And when you breach, it's a penalty or even cost you your job.
You're watching The Bahamas Tonight, The National Report. There's more news when we return.
This portion of the news is brought to you by Focal Smart Pass, the smart way to pay at the pump.
There are some things that are undeniably Bahamian. A good conch salad, Junkanoo, the way we worship, the way we take care of one another, all undeniably Bahamian. And right in the midst of our iconic things, places, and people is Commonwealth Bank. Increasing access, sponsoring dreams, working alongside Bahamians to increase the quality of their lives for more than 60 years. Commonwealth Bank, nothing more than being Bahamian. Commonwealth Bank, leader in personal banking services.
Strangers to different KFC menus to see if the flavor can enhance any moment. And at the first bite, the party began. We repeated the experiment during the day, during business hours, on weekends, with sunshine, with rain. It's confirmed, any moment can be a KFC moment.
Since 1974, the National Insurance Board has been an income replacement safety net.
But to ensure our future remains secure, starting July 1st, 2024, contribution rates will increase and will continue to be shared by employers and employees.
We will be sharing more information in the upcoming months. But for now, get more details on NIBRateIncrease.com.
Invest in tomorrow today with NIB.
Because together, we can ensure our financial future.
I have no idea what's coming.
Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready?
The best of the best. Keep the vibes alive. Music group Alpha Sound Promotions presents the best of the best broken straight explosion. As we ignite the grounds of Super Club Breezes, KB, Gino D, Funky B, Veronica Bishop, Ivy, the Verylanders, Elon Moxley, Shine 242.
Get your tickets now, available online at BahamasEtickets.com or swing by the Beauty Shack on Soldier Road and Carmichael Road.
And we're not done yet. The Falcons, Shag Collie and the VIPs, Pat Ramey, Stevie S, Johnny Cake, Iron Store, Novi, Mama D, and Nishi LS. Sky Boxes and Sky Bars available. Call 394-0819. The best of the best break and scrape explosion. Dates open at 6 p.m. May 11th at Super Club Breezer.
Incredible. It combines two unique styles and has a base with an exquisite texture. So delicious.
Mmm, a cheddar cheese base and a talking painting. Very unexpected.
Try an unexpected combination. Very unexpected. The new slices and sticks. Cheesy cheddar, pepperoni, cheese sticks, and a delicious cheddar cheese base. Only available at Little Caesars. Order your slices and sticks today at any of our locations. Prince Charles in the One East Plaza, Oaksfield Shopping Plaza, Carmichael Road, East Street South in the Pine Apple Plaza, and the Charles Saunders Highway.
Pizza, pizza.
Scores of Bahamians flooded the Gladstone Road Farmers Market grounds this weekend for the highly anticipated Agri Business Expo 2024. The expo returned after a five-year hiatus and has returned bigger and better than before.
To be quite honest with you, my overall thoughts are really based on the feedback we've been getting from the patrons and the vendors. And so to sum it up, I would say it's an outstanding success. we've heard that there, you know, could have been a bit more tweaking to be done, and we'll work on that for next time. But overall, it was a successful event. We had a large number of persons walking through patronizing, and I can say now that we have multiple stalls that have sold out. And even though it's winding down, as you can see, the crowd is still coming in. So obviously, this is something that the Bahamian public was looking forward to, and we're going to make sure we present it again to them in a much finer fashion next time around.
Attendees had a number of agricultural opportunities within arm's length of them, from experiencing a live birth at the livestock exhibition to a number of lecture series farmers and aspiring farmers can take advantage of. These lectures proved to be a success, according to Agriculture Minister Jomo Campbell.
Anytime, you know, anytime you can keep persons' attention without having music or entertainment, just educational sessions, then you know that it's really something that people are interested in. And each session was almost full to capacity. So people want to learn, people want the knowledge, because persons are interested in feeding themselves. And I can see that they're happy that this is something that the ministry is doing, and we are partnering with everybody. You know, the Golden Yoke session went extremely well. The Pineapple Project session went extremely well. The cooperative session went extremely well, and it was all received very well by the general public. And, you know, I look forward to what our next Agribusiness Expo is going to look like.
And based on the interest expressed, Minister Campbell says this.
I think the future for agriculture in the Bahamas is bright. We had over a dozen schools participating. And when persons came in and saw the level of expertise being displayed by the students, that really was shocking and mind-blowing to them. And to have the younger generation so interested, so passionate, so, you know, so involved in agriculture, in growing, in animal husbandry, I mean, it's amazing, it's exciting. And they have bought into the vision that we have to achieve food security for ourselves, and even to try to do it beyond 2025. And we want to remind people, agriculture is indeed Bahamian culture.
Attendees of the expo also echoed the minister's sentiments.
I came here with an air of gratitude just to be able to be out here and experience this event.
The expo was great and rewarding. A lot of organic stuff, stuff that is from the root and not chemically made. So that is good because it will heal our bodies.
I guess the highlight for me of this whole event was being able to showcase what my students are able to do down in the Baca program, sure, and have them come out and experience these things.
Keeping you in the know with Good to Grow, I'm Leah Cooper. Wondered about the role a hurricane aircraft plays in tracking the intensity and speed of a storm? Well, the local media got a chance to tour that very aircraft this morning at Odyssey Aviation. LaDon Davis was there.
When the hurricane hunter gets a call from the National Hurricane Center that a hurricane is fast approaching here in the Bahamas, the five-member crew on board immediately flies into the high of the storm to collect data. Lieutenant Kate McLaughlin gave a breakdown on the data collection process.
The drop zone will be released from the airplane, go down to the sea surface, and it creates a vertical profile of the atmosphere. So that includes like temperature, dew point, wind speed, wind direction, and pressure. And that data, the drop zone, is very important, and it is sent directly and ingested into some of the numerical models. Those numerical models, of course, are used by the forecasters to make a better forecast, both directionally and for the intensity. And our primary job as the weather officer on board is to quality control that data that we're releasing, but also to use that data to direct the pilots up front as to exactly where to go, because our main goal is to find that exact center of the storm.
Colorado State University predicts this year's Atlantic hurricane season will be extremely active. The forecast calls for as many as 23 named storms, 11 of which will become hurricanes. Of that number, five are expected to become major hurricanes of Category 3 or above. But how does a hurricane hunter track more than one storm brewing in the tropics?
We are actually manned enough by the National Hurricane Operations Plan in order to fly three storms at one time. And And what a lot of people don't realize is they say, well, how often does that happen? And it actually happens more than you would believe. At least one time a season we'll be tasked for three, but it's also because of our area of operations is really, really large. So we fly these storms out to the middle of the Atlantic, all through the Caribbean, and then we also fly storms in the Pacific out to Hawaii.
Director of Meteorology Jeffrey Simmons confirms this is the first time that a Hurricane Hunter has landed on Bahamian soil. The storm chasers will be offering storm tracking tours before their wheels go up on Wednesday morning.
Every year, during the month of May, is considered Hurricane Preparedness Month, as planned by NEMA. So, you know, in a collaboration with NEMA, we are, the Department of Meteorology has invited the Hurricane Hunter to come. Now, this is something that they do every year. They have selective islands that they would do every year, or countries, I would say. So this year, they are actually going into the Bahamas, then they go on to Barbados, St. Lucia, and then to Puerto Rico. So those four countries, those four places that they'll be visiting this year.
Now, it's just under two more months to go before the active Atlantic hurricane season begins, and meteorologists are encouraging Bahamians everywhere to prepare. For the Bahamas Tonight, I'm LaDawn Davis.
Thanks, LaDawn. For nearly 250 years, the who's who in the Anglo-Saxon community have gathered in New York for the St. George's Society of New York's British Ball. Tonight, no different, as Bahamian His Excellency Lowell Mortimer will be one of the recipients at tonight's ball. Devante Hanna joins us live from New York with the details. Devante, what can you tell us?
Well, good evening, Makushla. We are at the Pierra in bustling New York City. And in just a few moments, His Excellency Lowell Mortimer will be honored with the Commonwealth Award from the St. George's Society of New York here at their annual British Ball. It's a ball that's been happening for nearly 250 years where it honors Bahamians and people specifically from British background as well as Commonwealth nations heritage who have done outstanding work in terms of their nation development to their respective countries. Tonight, Lowell Mortimer will be honored for his work in maritime education as the principal for Mortimer & Co., as well as the president of Campbell Shipping Services. He has done outstanding work, according to the organizers here of this event. Now, this is one very prestigious event, and as you can see, it's black tie, and at the end of the night, His Excellency Mortimer will walk away with that Commonwealth Award, and we'll be on the inside to capture it all. But for now, on behalf of my photojournalist and I, Mario Munnings, reporting from the Pierre in beautiful New York City for the Bahamas Tonight, I'm Devante Hanna.
Well, thanks, Devante. Back here at home, Cisco Bahamas, operating under the umbrella of Bahamas Food Services, recently staged its Spring Food Expo. With the details, we turn now to our Amajal Knowles.
Cisco Bahamas Spring Food Expo was the talk of the town last week. But first, what exactly is Cisco Bahamas? Here's Ahmad Rashad Thompson, Learning and Development Manager for Cisco Bahamas, to fill us in.
Cisco Bahamas is the largest food service distributor in the Bahamas and on this planet. So we literally take our purpose very seriously, which is connecting the world to share food and care for one another. We shy away from retail. We want customers who have organizations, businesses, food kitchens, hotels, schools, wherever you need food, Cisco can provide it. And so we're really a dynamic wholesale provider that allows customers to get accounts with us and be able to establish their business and their unique footprint in and with Cisco Bahamas.
On April 11th at Cisco's Spring Food Expo, international vendors showcased everything from food to drinks to restaurant cleaning supplies and more. Chef Jonathan Keegan, corporate executive chef for Cisco Bahamas, tells us what it took to bring this expo together.
A lot of planning, a lot of planning. Crossing your T's and dotting your I's about three times each. And just communication, that's the key thing. Make sure all the departments communicate with each other. Make sure the orders are straight, that all the vendors have their product in, and all the students that are here from UB are doing what they're assigned to do.
Now, how was this expo different from previous ones?
This one was more elaborate because we had the chef competition. We also had the UB students do a demonstration for the tasting for the clientele. And the vendors were more food heavy this event. So we had a lot more cooking going on, products being sampled and tested in the kitchen and delivered to the floor. There's a lot more vendors than there was the last time.
The expo was only open to Sysco customers. Casey Cawley, the Sysco Bahamas Customer Service Manager, explains how easy it is to become one.
With the Sysco Shop, you first need an account, which is very easy to get. You go onto our website at SyscoBahamas.com, fill out the application comes to us, we then in turn process it and then send you your login credentials. Once you get in, you're in.
If you're in the food industry and not a Sysco customer yet, you might want to look into it. Just listen to what's coming up for Sysco customers.
Listen, September is going to be a month, remember, like I said, it is all hush-hush for right now. We want you to come. If you missed this show, don't worry. We have more opportunities for you in September where you do not. You cannot afford to miss September's food show. I guarantee you, you will not regret it.
Well, we still have more news to come, but Marcellus Hall has a look at what's coming up in sports. Marcellus?
Coming up in sports for tonight, Team Bahamas named for the upcoming World Relays. Tell you all about that just ahead in sports.
If you see news in the making, call ZNS News at 502-3800 or email us at znsnews@gmail.com.
In the Yellow Elder Garden, Ali and her cousins listen to Grammy share tales. The 70s so sweet, with themed costumes and dancing feet. Then came the brass, reaching new heights. A symphony of Bahamian nights. The 2000s, the Yellow Elder, a symbol of pride. Grammy's legacy in view as Ali dances in her Yellow Elder costume. We are alive.
Simplified Lending, we know that your time is precious. So we've unscrambled the loan process, making it fast and hassle-free. You can have your answer in as little as 24 hours. When you qualify, we simplify. We are the best borrowing solution for tuition, home renovation, vacation loans, emergency medical expenses, purchasing a vehicle, and for business expansion loans. Simplified Lending, for simplified living. Call us today or find us in the R&D Plaza on JFK Drive.
After 51 years, Popeyes is crashing the wings party with 5 flavors.
Makes no sense it took so long. Crispy outside, juicy inside.
Who are you?
We don't make sense. We make chicken. Y'all good?
Popeyes' new chicken wings make no sense. Marinated in Louisiana spices, hand-battered and flipped, and then we have the audacity to call all 5 flavors fast food? Someone should really say something or order something.
Love that chicken from Popeyes.
Now available at Popeyes in Nassau.
The BCB's partnership with Centerville Primary positively impacting the lives of students. One need only consider the fact that today, more than 20 boys successfully completed training that looks to change the trajectory of their lives. Vaughn Albury was there.
The 23 boys, 5th and 6th graders, according to Club 1600's Dwayne Wallace, are perhaps the first primary school students to become Gavel Club members, Junior Toastmasters. This after completing a 10-week leadership training program. The Broadcasting Corporation partnered with Club 1600 under a common goal, to improve the lives of Centerville primary students, especially boys, using the tool of communication. In fact, ZNS General Manager Clint Watson says it's more than being able to speak.
You've got to be able to work through difficult situations. And that is what the foundation of Toastmasters is doing for you. It's teaching you to not only be a good speaker, but to be able to interact with your friends, your peers, to be able to make strong decisions when you come around people who may want you to do something that's not good. The foundation that you get in Toastmasters will help you to be able to stand strong, stand firm, and to resolve conflicts.
The Minister of National Security, the Honorable Wayne Munro, a former student, told the successful group that they will face choices, even simple ones, which could impact their lives after.
Whether to talk in class. If you make that choice, then you're not going to be able to hear what the teacher has to say, and not hearing what the teacher has to say will put you at a disadvantage when it comes to your lessons, to your exams. I cannot tell you how many people now want to be Defense Force, Marines and officers, police officers, who, when they come, they just lack one BJC because they made a choice that put them in that position.
Principal Katharina Williams is happy that partnering with ZNS has brought in new opportunities.
This is what these kinds of opportunities will do for our children as we are building boys to become men. When we started this particular school year, we started with the theme of building stronger together. And because especially the partnership that we have forged with the Broadcasting Corporation of the Bahamas, I can say we have seen so many other offshoots of this particular partnership.
And so this partnership with the Broadcasting Corporation of the Bahamas and Toastmasters Club 1600 is producing positive results. Indeed, the school's GPA has improved, lifting this school within the Eastern New Providence Primary School District. It's a winning combination here at Centerville Primary, partnering with civic and corporate entities to lift all of our children. For the Bahamas Tonight, I am Vaughn Albury.
Also talking education, Nacho Nash Junior High students continue to soar. Their exceptional grades in the Bahamas Junior Certificate Examinations, proof leading them to them being scouted by top high schools in the capital. Last year, student Zante Ferguson walked away with 12 A's, the highest for a junior high student in this country. Principal Andre Nairn says he's hoping for even better grades this year.
HNS has a culture of excellence, a culture where, you know, students expect, they're expected to do well. We have high expectations of our students, not only administrators and teachers, but also parents and students themselves. You know, we have a wall that we call a wall where we put our students when they do well. And so we encourage all of our students to go up on the wall with the pictures, their photos, and their examination results, go up on the wall. This year, we would have had 31 students on the wall, students who receive 8 or more A's in BJC examinations.
The Trinidad and Tobago Manufacturers Association is hoping to establish trade links with the Bahamas. The association this week on what CEO Ramesh Ramadeen says is a fact-finding mission, as it is interested in exporting and sourcing materials from the Bahamas back home.
We did some market surveys yesterday and we went out and we see the prices that the Bahamian people are paying for products that we could offer to the Bahamian people, and it's very comparative. We think that we could come in even better than some of the prices we've seen in the supermarket retail level. Our products, our goods, our services produced in Trinidad and Tobago are top class goods that could compete with any country in the Caribbean and North America. We do export already significantly to North America and Europe, so our standards and qualities are there. So it's not a question of whether we bring in inferior products into Bahamas. We really feel that we could bring, and our culture, our tastes are similar, so we acquiesce with each other. So we really feel that we can make a significant interjection into the Bahamian market of our goods and services.
Assistant Director of Trade Promotion and Development for the Trinidad Promotion Board and Trinidad's Ministry of Trade and Industry, Neville Alexander, and Deputy Chair of the Bahamas Trade Commission, Senator the Honorable Barry Griffin, are excited about the possibilities.
Hopefully, we are able to get some agreements, some partnerships. I know we have some members of the party that have already reached out to some suppliers, business partners, and it has been very encouraging what we have heard so far from those discussions.
Trade and business within and between Caribbean countries are essential drivers of economic growth and development. By harnessing the collective strengths and resources of our nations, we can unlock new opportunities, drive innovation, and promote sustainable development across the region.
In a monumental display of faith and unity, the world church leader of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Dr. Ellie Henry, has embarked on a series of visits to SDA churches across New Providence. With followers eagerly anticipating his arrival, this visit aims to teach members about the history of the Atlantic Caribbean Union of Seventh-day Adventists, church growth initiatives, and strengthening relationships with leaders.
The Seventh-day Adventist Church is a worldwide church, and we have the possibility, all of us, to be together, united in the same purpose, and working together to bring the people of God in a good experience.
Now, when asked if he found inspiration from his visit, here's what Dr. Henry said.
How the children to do agriculture. We know that, for instance, you are very dependent on what is coming from abroad. But so teaching the kids, the youth, that they can also have their own garden and grow something for themselves is something that we want to export also. The idea, eh?
Princess Naima, Chapter 1127, hosting its inaugural high tea party. Fill My Cup, as it's called, combined elegance with a noble cause.
This year in particular, we would like to expand our reach to the Family Islands by doing some community service projects in the Family Islands. And this fundraiser, once successful, which we know will be successful, will help us to do that. We have within the chapter a year-long toy drive to give toys to some of the children in the Family Islands. We realize that Nassau, although in need as well, is always on the receiving end, and so we want to expand that reach. So we chose a tea party because the ladies of Princess Naima, Chapter 1127, are very different. We like to think out of the box. We also like to have a good time. We also fellowship using tea. So we thought of bringing this initiative to our friends and family as a way to raise money for our initiatives.
Still to come, our feature, Old Nassau, spicing up Toronto. You're watching The Bahamas Tonight, the National Report. There's more news in a moment.
Mother's Day is coming up, and I'm thinking about upgrading my kids' mother's kitchen.
Man, I thought your children's mother was married to another man. You have to know when to let go. This is powerful. You know what? I'm going to upgrade my wife's kitchen for Mother's Day. I am sure she would love that.
I think so, too. Check out Cornet Bahamas. They're having a pre-Mother's Day sale, 35% off store-wide, starting April 16th to May 16th. The Sandy Port Plaza, Freeport, Abaco, and Ilu.
Shaunae Miliwemo tying up, but it doesn't matter. It's gold for the Olympic champion.
On May 4th and 5th, the sun will shine down on the Thomas A. Robinson Stadium. Hundreds of the world's best track athletes from more than 40 countries will compete to qualify for their spot at the Paris Olympics.
Introducing the Focal Smart Pass app that helps you to fuel up faster. Here's how it works. Download the app on the App Store or get it on Google Play and create your profile with payment details. Visit your nearest Shell station, open the app, scan the pump's QR code, select your payment amount, and begin fueling. Say goodbye to cash and cards because the Focal Smart Pass offers secure and convenient payment options right at your fingertips. Download Focal Smart Pass now and fuel up faster today.
In just a matter of weeks, construction will begin on Abaco's new police headquarters. The ceremony held at the Marsh Harbor Government Complex Monday, where plans were unveiled for the new facility. Desmond Saunders was there.
The new multi-million dollar police complex expected to replace the ruined structure on George Aubrey Boulevard in Marsh Harbor, Abaco, destroyed by 2019's Hurricane Dorian. With an uptick in violent crime and in the face of an economic upswing, Member of Parliament for North Abaco, Kirk Cornish, and his colleague, Central and South Abaco MP John Pender, believes the proposed construction is just what this community needs.
What we want to do is put something here that we are proud of and something that the future generations of the Royal Bahamas Police Force will be able to utilize to serve and protect. This is a building that will allow them the tools they need. This is not something to take very lightly.
We are achieving a boulder. And in achieving this, I ask every sensible thinking Abaconian, I'm not suggesting that you ignore our needs, but rather than focus on what we don't have, celebrate what you're having, what you're getting.
The proposed police headquarters will sit on 8 acres of land south of the Marsh Harbor Airport. It will house 6 holding cells, a records office and screening room, have accommodations for police officers and a garage for 2 ambulances. Chief Superintendent for the Abaco Division, Will Hart, says he and his team have outgrown the existing space within the Marsh Harbor Government Complex.
They stand on the shoulders of many officers in charge who have been in the trenches working under conditions that they were under, and I applaud them for that. I stand here now, I cannot forget them. And I also want to thank my officers in Abaco Division for the sterling work, the performance they're doing under the conditions that they're working under.
Shovels will hit the ground in the coming weeks for the new Abaco Police Headquarters. The proposed construction expected to provide employment for scores of Abaconians. More importantly, it will give the necessary resources for Abaco Police to serve and protect with distinction. Here in Abaco, for the Bahamas Tonight, I'm Desmond Saunders.
Now, Abaco, a boating, fishing, and sailing paradise, already seeing an upswing in visitor arrivals this year. Member of Parliament for Central and South Abaco and Parliamentary Secretary in the Ministry of Tourism, John Pinder, says there's a 13% increase over last year.
Our friends from abroad is what I like to call them. And they're coming in droves, and they're telling their friends, and their friends are telling their friends. They're coming by boat, by plane. They're staying at all of our various establishments. Abaco's a special place. We can cater to those with a relatively small budget, or we can cater to those that come down in their own private jets. So what I've been doing is driving for 2 years, over 2 years, in putting Abaco back on the mapping, showing them that our facilities are being rebuilt and being rebuilt back to a better level than they were before. All of our marinas are filling up. We're expected to have a tremendous season. The fishing is really great down here. The culture, the people, and Abaco is only a stone throws away from our biggest market, which is the United States. So it's a easy in, easy out.
Pinder says that the island's leisure and pleasure craft market also seeing phenomenal growth.
You were showing very strong signs in yachting. I was just passing by the boats the other day, and the number of sailboats are out there, but the number of super yachts anchored throughout the seas of Abaco's show that this is not just hot for fly-in tourism, but yachting. And yachts are one of those special things. You don't expect them to bring a great revenue into the islands, but they truly do. They're the ones going out to dinner. They're the ones fueling their boats and provisioning and utilizing those mom and pop gift stores and whatnot throughout the Keys and on the mainland as well.
Well, it's now time for a check on Family Island weather with Chief Meteorologist Basil Dean. Good evening, Basil.
Good evening, Makisha. We have patchy clouds this evening. Temperature at 74 degrees. Your relative humidity, it's climbing, 77%. The wind's out of the east-northeast at 11 miles per hour. Your barometric pressure, 1,018.7 millibars. That is 30.08 inches. And your temperatures around the Family Islands this evening, 77 degrees in Marsh, Abaco, Greentul, Key at 75. Also in Freeport, Grand Bahama and the Berry Islands, Alistair, Bimini, 77. Harbor Island, 75. Roxanne, Lutra, 75 degrees, 75. Also in Fresh Creek, Central Andros, Kemp's Bay, South Andros, Black Point, Exuma, Artistan, Kid Island at 76 degrees, San Salvador, 75. In Rumpke, they have a temperature of 77 degrees. 77s again in Rigel Island, Clarence Sound, Long Island, and Crooked Island. Betsy Bay, Miguana, 78. Ackland, 78. Matthewtown, Unagra is a warm spot this evening at 80 degrees. And the Turks and Caicos Islands at 79 degrees. And your boating forecast tonight through tomorrow in the northwestern islands. Those winds remain easterly at 12 to 18 knots, the wave fights 3 to 6 feet with a moderate chop in place. Now, the low tide that will occur at 9:30 tonight, another low tide at 10:29 tomorrow morning for the central and southeast. Eastern Islands tonight through Wednesday. Easterly winds 15 to 20 knots Those wave heights, they continue to be choppy at 4 to 7 feet over the ocean, and hence we keep that caution flag in place for Central and Southeastern Islands through Wednesday. And then on Thursday, we will see a reduction in those winds becoming easterly at 10 to 15 knots in the northwestern islands, the wave heights subsiding 2 to 4 feet, so we'll drop the caution flag for the northwest Bahamas on Thursday. Now, your low tide, 11:19 in the morning, high tide at 5:21 in the afternoon for the Central and Southeastern Islands on Thursday. Those winds unchanged, they remain out of the east at 15 to 20 knots and the wave heights 4 to 7 feet with caution flags remaining in place. That's going to do it for your boating forecast. It's time now for your international temperatures, and they're brought to you by Royal Star Assurance.
Looking nice, she blow my mind. Right on the side. I start all the drinks on night.
And that's going to do it for your international temperatures, brought to you by Royal Star Assurance. But stay tuned, your extended weather forecast is still ahead.
Want to have your voice heard? Send your letters to the editor to digitalmedia@znsbahamas.com. Share your thoughts on current events or positive stories within your community. That's digitalmedia@znsbahamas.com. We want to hear from you.
The most important thing in life is family, and whenever you need reliable advice, you look to the people you know you can trust. At J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers, we earn our clients' trust every day. Whether it's home, motor, travel, or commercial insurance, we've got you covered. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com.
J.S. Johnson Insurance. Peace of mind.
This is ZNS Total Sports.
Welcome to your ZNS Total Sports Check, everybody. I'm Marcellus Hall. Well, the Bahamas will field a 27-member squad to contest 4 of the 5 events at the upcoming World Relays. Men and women's 4x1, mixed relay, and men's 4x4, as well as the women's 4x100. Let's give you a look at that 4x100-meter team. That'll be Camille Rutherford, Devin Charlton, Prantasia Johnson, Jemiah Nabi, Cheyenne Demerit, Naya Richards, Charisma Taylor, and Padria Seymour. Now, for the men, Samson Colbert, Somali Farrington, Ian Kerr, Carlos Brown, Deidre Clark making the cut, Blake Bartlett, Jeremiah Adley, and Warren Frazier. Looking at the men's 4x4 lineup now, Stephen Gardner, Alonzo Russell, Wendell Miller, Zion Shepherd, Deidre Clark, Zion Miller, Levine Joseph, Shaquem Hall-Smith. And as far as the mixed relay is concerned, Shawnee Miller-Webo on that squad, along with Anthony Strawn, LaCarthia Cooper, Robin Roll Curry, Stephen Gardner, Alonzo Russell, Wendell Miller, and Zion Shepherd. Team leader is David Charlton. He'll be assisted by Sean Miller, Pauline Davis-Thompson, Ramon Miller, and Tyrone Burrows. Now, Shawnee Miller-Webo will be on that squad, as you saw, participating in the mixed relay. The Olympic and world champion gold medalist talked about the experience of being a new mom.
Being a mom has been the greatest feeling in the world, and I wouldn't trade it for the world. But, you know, he's my joy, he's my pride, and yeah, I'm just doing everything just to make him proud.
To the NBA, where Kai Jones is now back in the NBA full-time. Jones signing a multi-year deal with the playoff-bound LA Clippers. Kai introduced to the public and spoke about the opportunity of being able to return to the league.
This is the best opportunity of my basketball career. I'm super happy to be here, super grateful for the opportunity, and glad that the organization sees something in me and trusts me and give me this chance to work my way back in and make the most out of this opportunity.
And Kai, what has the conversation been with Coach Ty Lue?
It's been great. We spoke about what he expects from me, my role coming into this team. And, you know, we talked about some of the plays and the coverages that he wants to see me execute for the team. And, you know, he thinks that I can add a lot of length and speed and agility and help protect the rim, help us win games.
One half of the New Province Basketball Association Championship Series all done. Your Essential Food Store Giants, 77-66 winners last night. Game 3 over the Protos Express Rockets. They sweep that Division II series, advancing now to the Bahamas Basketball Federation Round Robin Nationals. That'll take place this weekend in South Andros. Brandon Ingram had a game-high 30 points, 11 rebounds in that win. Kirkland Farrington chipped in with 14 points. Matthew Saunders and Samar Roll had 10 apiece. Now, looking ahead to Game 3 of the Division One series tonight, Commonwealth Bank Giants and Discount Liquor Rockets, they're all even, one game apiece. That game should be a pretty good one this evening. And the University of the Bahamas set to host another edition of the annual UB Fit fundraiser this weekend. UB Fit co-chair Candice Eldon talking about what's in store for this Saturday.
It's a culmination of everyone that loves UB. We have running, we have walking, biking, skating, pushing, rollerblading. We have a 5K, a 10K, and a 15K. So it's an opportunity for corporate Bahamas, for church groups, civic group organizations to come up with their families and just have a really great morning supporting the University of the Bahamas and also celebrating the university's 50th anniversary.
And that's it, your look at sports for you today. Meanwhile, a look at the weather is just around the corner. Stay with us.
This is ZNS Total Sports.
You watch them grow and make plans for them even before they're old enough to talk. You spend a lifetime of sacrifice to pave the way for their success and create a tomorrow you too can be proud of. Can you tell who is the investor? At Lend, we believe everyone who has ever put a penny aside for a future dream is an investor. If you're new to investing, Lend's financial experts stand ready to design plans based on your goals. Let's sit down and explore the options one-on-one and see how, together, we can make your dreams come true. Whether considering traditional investments like a new home, car, your own business, security and retirement, or your child's college fund, we take the confusion out of the process and make an investor out of you. Call 396-3225 for an appointment. Leno, your bridge to the future.
Have you ever purchased a defective item and was denied an exchange or cash refund? Contact the Consumer Protection Commission at 393-7795-8 or our 24-hour complaints hotline at 357-7898. And let us help your voice be heard.
Hey, get up, stand up. Stand up for your life.
Time now for weather.
In our final look at weather, we have a blocking high pressure to the south of the United States, and that's going to prevent this frontal system from getting to us. It's going to push towards the north and east, and that means for the next several days we will continue to enjoy some very toasty days and some mild night conditions. Now, our satellite picture showing that old frontal boundary now well to the south and east of the Bahamas. High pressure remaining in control, but we have some clouds starting to be advected into the northwest Bahamas, which will create some patchy cloudy conditions over the next a couple of days. Tonight, though, we're looking at breezy and partly cloudy with a low temperature of 71 degrees. Tomorrow, it's going to be mostly sunny and windy again with the high temperature climbing up to 80 degrees. Now, your extended weather forecast, weather's going to remain pretty nice with lots of sunshine in our forecast for the next 7 days. That will take us right into Tuesday of next week. those temperatures during the daytime, they're going to start climbing as we get into the weekend up to about 84 degrees, and that will continue to trend upwards as we head into the early part of next week. Now, the nights, as we promised you already, will remain pretty mild, even though temperatures are starting to climb a bit. They will stay into the low 70s during the nighttime, and that's going to be pretty comfortable until we start to get into the weekend, where we see temperatures dropping back to 69 degrees temporarily, and then that warming trend begins again on Monday of next week. Mikisha.
Well, thanks, Basil. And this next one for all you foodies out there. Food traditions are a big deal in Canada, be it in the form of Michelin-starred restaurants to hole-in-the-wall diners. The options are many. So when the taste of the Bahamas makes its way to Toronto and overnight becomes a TikTok viral sensation, that speaks volumes. In this report, our Charlia Jones tells the story of a famous food critic's glowing review and its phenomenal impact on a Bahamian business.
They call it the Keith Lee effect.
Hi, Keith Lee. This is Kay, and this is my daughter, Kenzie, and we're inviting you to come to our restaurant, Old Nassau.
I got it. Let's try it. And ready to 10.
Kaylandra Edgecombe, owner of Old Nassau in Canada, is the latest beneficiary of what the internet has dubbed the Keith Lee effect. Most commonly known for his food reviews on the TikTok platform, Lee has garnered millions of fans who swarm every establishment he suggests. His recent stop to the Toronto Gem, putting Bahamian dishes on the map.
And then the opportunity for the restaurant came up, and I couldn't, like, not do it. So back in 2017, when I started it, it was because of the lack. There was no representation of Bahamian food or our culture, really, in Canada or Toronto, I could speak about specifically.
With Lee's Old Nassau review now reaching over 4.1 million views, Edgecombe says the support from her fellow Bahamians and international supporters have been overwhelming, but she's grateful.
Bahamians are doing it, yeah, and the Bahamians from the Bahamas who ain't never even been here, like, they're on it. Like, he asked me, he's like, what's all the 242 in the comments? I'm like, that's our area code, you know. It was very, very overwhelming because it was like, wow, they really, really stick together and they really do what they got to do for their people. But like to see it actually happen for me, like I'm one of the Bahamians that is doing something good and that you guys are supporting, that was special for me.
Edgecombe says she anticipated the effect of Lee's review.
We were prepared for this influx, even though I didn't know when it was going to come, but I was prayerful and it happened. And I just want to do whatever it takes to maintain it.
As for her supporters, she shares this message.
I thank everybody for the encouragement. I do have a few suppliers in the Bahamas. Everybody has been great to me, great to my business. I just want to really let you guys know I really appreciate y'all. So I just had to do it for my people. I had to do it for my culture. I had to do it for me.
For the Bahamas Tonight, I'm Charlia Jones.
And that does it for the Bahamas Tonight. Thank you for continuing to make ZNS your first choice for news and information. Only the sun covers the Bahamas better than ZNS. From all of us here at ZNS, thank you for watching and good night.